Right. A very good morning to each one of you here. And I'm from Delhi, so this I feel is a very pleasant weather now. Delhi is a bit, even today it's cold. And Bangalore is my second home, so I'm quite happy to be here as long as SuryaCon wants me to stay back here. It's a wonderful crowd, and I believe everyone here has invested their time, money and resources in this sector, so everybody should benefit out of this conversation. So we'll make this panel discussion as relevant as possible, not just kind of just throwing out the ideas and challenges, but also give some solutions. And as Damien said, it's yes, we have challenges, but still we are moving forward, and we will definitely come together. And that's the biggest idea I liked, that how we sitting in this room also should be together outside as well, and then try to really give the synchronization, not in the net meeting, but in our thoughts, so that we give that synchronization in such a way that the message is clear and the market is also moving the way you want and we want. So that's a kind of an opening remark, but just I'll give you 1 minute introduction about me. So I am the team leader for $13 million World Bank SBI MNRE Technical Assistance Program, exclusively designed for implementing rooftop solar. And this is MNRE Technical Assistance Program. And this came as a result of $625 million given as a concessional loan by World Bank to SBI way back in 2016. And so far, the SBI has released or disbursed close to $300+ million. And large portion of that is SMEs. So that's a big story there. And we as a technical program, I work for Ernst & Young. We have a project management unit, and we work with another five partners. And we try to create the enabling ecosystem in terms of capacity building, the training part, which again Damien mentioned, the policy and regulation, demand aggregation, media outreach, creating awareness, and also process streamlining in terms of online portals for the unified web portals for net metering. So we do this in 17 states, 31 DISCOMs. As we speak, around 50 engineers are working on ground from our consultancy organization. We have trained over 1,200 stakeholders across the board in terms of the field engineers, the developers, the utility senior and middle level management, entrepreneurs, and also the bankers, especially the SBI bankers. We have trained more than 300 plus bankers across the country. So that's a way we try to connect with you, because unless the market players are there, this enabling ecosystem is not going to really fly. It's a two-way process, and it is not a top-down where you are trusted with something which you don't agree in principle, but then you don't have any solution moving forward. So it's a two-way process. So I personally travel across all my 17 states. Unfortunately, Karnataka is not in our pool. And that the good news is that ADB has launched a similar technical assistance program. So ADB has 7 states, all the South Indian states other than Andhra belongs to them. And they are running a technical assistance program, and they work with CREDL in Karnataka very closely and with the regulator. They also work with Andaman, Nicobar Islands and Lakshadweep, also exotic states, which I didn't get to visit in my pool. But I got all the 7 northeastern states, so I do travel a lot in those states as well. So a lot of experience and a lot of developers with whom I have interacted personally. We had kind of did a demand aggregation for 300 over megawatt, which means an online data room for all the 11 states out of 17, where the bidders can access these data before they bid for the government tenders. And out of that, 120 megawatt has been already bid out. Of course, implementation is happening as we speak. So right now, as you know, the focus is on residential sector by the Government of India. And therefore, we are trying to understand how that market has to be redefined. Again, as Damien said, it didn't really work in terms of the RESCO model overall. But again, for residential sector, it has never had a great experience. And RESCOs, they don't want 1 kilowatt, 2 kilowatt market anyway. So how to improvise that and how to align the MNRE's phase 2 program and how to really take it forward is my mission. I'm fully aware this panel is not for rooftop. There's a separate panel for rooftop. But I'm forced to introduce what I'm doing, so otherwise I don't get another opportunity. So that's my marketing pitch. So I have a very neutral position, and as a moderator, you always shut up after some time once you give the remarks. So I'm not going to talk after this. So that's a good news to you. But all the panelists, I don't want to disappoint anyone and you as well. So we will try to see as quickly as possible they can make a few opening remarks, if you agree, in terms of the overall presence they have, not a marketing pitch of themselves or the company, but at least the issues they feel very strongly, as Damien said. Of course, Damien talked about his growth, but definitely each and everyone in this room and in the panel have a strong history. But I request each one of the panel members to give a quick overview of the top challenges in both the utility and rooftop, if you may, because you're working more on that. And also we have in the panelist an expert from the IT side. So he's going to give you the importance of the monitoring aspect, the performance aspect as well. So I'm going to give a free, maybe a 2-minute overview of their views, strong views. And if you are finding a solution, I think start with a solution. We have heard enough about the problems. And we already the economy, we heard about what is happening in the economy, but let us try to get some good news in this room and make the kind of discussions live. So I'll start with sir, Narasimhan sir, to give his opening remarks, very, very limited and focused one, so that the rest of the panelists can then react to his remarks also and add to their remarks, sir.
Namaskar. In fact, I should have addressed the inaugural session, I got delayed. However, I'm happy to participate in whatever the panel session. And now the session is open for discussion on solar, what kind of debates we want to handle now.
It's more on the utility sector and some reference to rooftop as well.
Okay. I think Karnataka stands first in almost all the, whether utility or the rooftop. Utility already you cross 7,000 plus megawatt, rooftop already I think 200 megawatts they have reached. They are number one in South India and as well as in the other parts of India. I don't find much problem setting up the plants in Karnataka, either for the payment security system or any kind of disadvantages are not much there in Karnataka when you compare with other DISCOMs, when you compare with the other states. So here almost all the developers, all the investors might have been happy in the past and they're going to be happy in the future also. Is there any particular kind of struggles or constraints we can share? And as the Indian Solar Association, we are always ready to represent any kind of grievances to the high level. I hope all the panelists, those who are sitting here, they can also endorse the views. Currently, there are some issues regarding the safeguard duty or the kind of modules getting it from China or any other country. Some of the people they represented saying that China, all we know that it has been closed by because of the coronavirus for another 2-3 months. We are not going to get the free shipments from China. And already China is going to have their own internal developments also. So people, those who are, my sincere advice to the few developers in this country, they are the reason for reducing the tariffs, including because of them, people are getting affected. That's what my view. When you quote some kind of bid, the tariff, it should be healthy and it should be a financeable, bankable PPAs. This is one point I want to refer. Few companies, they quote at the very low tariff and other people are suffering because this country is not going to get any kind of funding at low cost. Every of the meeting, I used to say that low cost funding is not happening. And a company quote for bid at low price as an international company, they are accessible for the international low cost funding. Whereas the other mid-level companies, they can't get Indian funding is always 10 plus percentage. So this is also an important point, whether it's a Karnataka or any state which we want to mention and refer it. Otherwise, the cost of funding will kill the project, the viability, and none of the bankers are ready to give funding for the solar and any renewable energy. The government of India brings us under the priority sector and should be given as a priority lending. Commercial banks or any of the PSU banks are not so easily considering the solar project funding today. That's what the experience. Other than the state, central government institution like PFCA, REC, other than the DRIDA, remaining all are in the same pattern. They are not ready to fund at the low cost. So this is what one problem what personally I am also facing. And again, if you see today, on the safeguard, whether any guard, safeguard or any guard today, the module supply has been affected. So what I would like to request to all the panelists and as well as all the audience, those who are sitting here, instead of imposing, see today when China is banned or closed for some more months, where are we going to get the panels, my dear friends? This has to be debated. Of course, you signed a PPA, of course, you got everything. Today everything is getting imported blindly opposing a country. It's not going to happen. See, suppose we have a module factories only. We don't have much of the cell manufacturing companies. If we have a cell manufacturing, wafer has to be imported. If wafer has to be manufactured, then ingot has to be imported. It's a chain of supply. We don't have the chain of supply. This has to be given importance. The Karnataka government, I think Mr. Mahendra Jain, who has left before me, Karnataka is under the solid consideration. They want to go for end-to-end manufacturing as a first state in the country. Really, I would like to appreciate their activities, but they are also a little bit slow. These are the general grievances I am finding out from the industry. Then the regulation comes, then all other activities are coming. So my only serious and sincere request for the panelists and as well as the audience, we have to request the government of India either to remove the safeguard duty, not to impose any more duty on the solar panels imported from any of the countries. Some of the people written in the magazine saying that when China is not supplying, they have to pay about 25% more when they get it imported from other countries. How many of the industries in India we have a self-sustainable capacity to serve for the PPA signed in this country? We don't have that capacity. So this is to be seriously to be discussed and to be debated and represented to the government of India. They should remove the safeguard duty immediately, not to impose any more duty further for the next 2-3 years. Then only the projects will be implemented, will be generated power. Otherwise, we are going to face the problem. This is number one. Number two is the low-cost funding. This is also to be discussed, sir. And I would like to enlighten these points. These are the two major points before us for any kind of renewable industry. My friend from KPCL was talking about the land and all for the solar. And whether he was advocating really the thermal or not, I don't know. Thermal and all has been classified as the dirty energy in this country. Now the government and the country is moving for the clean energy under the renewable sector, whether it is solar, hydro or any kind of wind energy is to be given as the priority. So Karnataka also moving fast. They have crossed already 7,500 megawatt. They are the topmost in the country in all the activities. So these are the few points maybe beyond the scope of panelists here, but this is to be given a serious thought. Other than this, government of Karnataka or the regulators are here, they are more flexible and accessible as per my kind of what experience I had in Karnataka when you compare with all other states. And these are the important things. If there is any constraint or any kind of points to be discussed, I am always open up. We can represent anywhere. So friends, seriously give thought on this.
Thank you so much, sir. And by the way, I mean, he heads the Indian Solar Association.
Yeah,
so yeah, so you know, you have your friend on your right. Yeah. I think it's a valid point. I think he was very, very sharp in terms of the low cost financing is spot on, safeguard duty spot on, and Karnataka being flexible again spot on. My experience goes back since 2014 when I was working for a US program. It's always an open door policy here in terms of meeting any kind of bureaucrats or the experts. So that's these are all very valid points. But of course, as he said, a few may be out of our purview. We can't find a solution right now, but I think they are all really hitting the market right now as we speak, especially the import of panels from China. So let me quickly move to another interesting speaker or the panel, Girish from ICRA. As you know, ICRA does ratings, not IPL ratings, but power sector ratings. So he has to be really careful when he rates because he is following each and every movement in the market, especially the power and renewable. So he heads that division. And he is also sensitive in terms of how the market is moving, right? And therefore, he's a current expert and he can throw a lot of things in terms of what happens during the rating and how things get affected. But I also have a request to him. Does he do a fair play rating in terms of IPL? As sir was saying, is that a fair play in terms of aggressive bids happening in this country? Can we do a fair play rating in terms of the bids by the private players? So yeah, close, yes.
Yeah, thanks Dinesh Babu. Myself Girish, so I lead the power sector ratings at ICRA. ICRA is a rating agency and we have extensive coverage in our rating assignments across the value chain of the power sector. Let me quickly come to the point. So in the renewable energy sector, while the long term, the prospects for the sector are quite solid and quite positive. You know, thanks to, the policy thrust, which is fairly strong, both by the central government and also by the various state governments. So the policy thrust is very, very strong for promotion of the renewables in the long run. More importantly, the tariff dynamics have improved quite favorably, you know, both for wind and solar, okay? And that's quite cost competitive from the DISCOMs perspective, and DISCOMs are the ultimate off-takers, you know, for the renewables. So these are the two fundamental demand drivers for the renewables story to remain intact in the long run. Now, having said that, there are headwinds which we are seeing in the near term, and which is why the outlook is negative, from the ICRA perspective. Why? So there are a couple of factors. The number one factor is, as you must be aware, there are significant payment delays by the state DISCOMs in few states like AP, Telangana, Tamil Nadu, and so on. Particularly the larger overdue position from the DISCOMs in AP and Telangana. And in fact, that has impacted quite badly the liquidity profile for many entities that we rate, okay? In fact, so far, the liquidity has been supported by many of their parents, which are in majority of the cases, you know, the private equity players, either through their equity backup, unsecured loan support, and so on. But the liquidity position has been badly impacted because of the payment delays, and that's number one. Number two, there are significant tariff-related uncertainties which are still going on, especially in the state of AP, and where the matter is currently pending at APRC. So how quickly this tariff-related issue gets sorted out, it's something which is a key monitorable, you know, to bring back the investor interest in the renewables. And because of these issues, you know, the investor sentiments have been badly impacted in the renewable per se. In last, 8 to 10 month period, you can clearly see the subdued interest in the tendering plans, whether it is under NSM by SECI or NTPC or whether by under state policy route across the states. I mean, overall tendering activity has been quite subdued because of these fundamental issues which are going on in few states. Apart from that, we are also seeing, you know, significant challenges in land acquisition and also getting the transmission connectivity approvals. And because of which we have seen number of projects getting delayed, you know, okay? And that in turn has an impact on their respective credit profile as well, okay? So, and lastly, but not the least, the financial health of the state DISCOMs is a matter of concern, okay? Thanks to them, we started seeing improvement in the book loss position for this, the DISCOMs on a country basis in last 2 years. But apparently since last 1 year, we have again started seeing, you know, the liquidity position getting deteriorated and also the book losses going up for the state level DISCOMs on an aggregate basis. Okay. That's also because of inadequate tariff revision, which is happening all across the states, inadequate subsidy support, not being timely from the respective state governments and so on. And more importantly, poor focus on AT&C loss reduction by many of the DISCOMs. So these are the fundamental, you know, bottlenecks which is impacting the DISCOM's liquidity, and this in turn has a vicious impact on their payment pattern towards the GenCos, including the renewable players. Lastly, but not the least, again, the grid integration challenges and the transmission adequacy, okay, which could be a matter of concern going ahead in few concentrated zones like in northern and also in the southern belt, where we are seeing rampant renewable capacity addition coming up, especially for Karnataka, when 50% of the installed capacity is actually renewable energy based, there could be possibilities of, you know, the grid curtailment, okay? Given the fact that Karnataka is already power surplus and we have started seeing certain cases of grid curtailment happening for few wind stations as well, okay? And in that context, the grid adequacy is becomes a very, very important issue. And that needs to be addressed both at intrastate level by the state level transcos and also by the PGCL as part of the green energy corridor, which is currently underway, even though the progress has been not to the up to the mark, which otherwise should have been there. So these are the challenges which are currently going on and impacting the overall renewable energy sector. And because of which, in last 6 to 8 months, almost 1/3 of our rated portfolio has actually seen the rating action in terms of the downward rating revisions, and many of these ratings are under negative outlook. So the key monitorables, A, the regulatory issue resolution in state like AP, and how fast, you know, the bottlenecks related to land and the transmission connectivity approvals get removed on a pan-India basis in few states. So these are something which are the few monitorables to be watched out in our view. Thanks.
I think again, very crisp and direct relevance in terms of what is happening in the market and how you and me are affected in terms of our returns on the investments that we make. That's why it is very important to understand This is on a continuous basis. I'm not promoting ICRA here, but they are supposed to be watched out in terms of how they are trying to understand the market movement and how they rate you and me in terms of our performance. But it is a natural reflection of what is happening in the state. So